thank you that we have this incredible place to come and learn about you and sing about you and God, find out that you came and you lived among us. You gave us hope. You gave us peace. So rain down that peace on us right now. We desperately need it, God, and we're calling on you. You are our peace, and we ask this in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. Amen. So if you followed the news just this week, our nation has encountered government officials lying to the FBI, more sexual misconduct charges against high-profile celebrities, a missile launched by North Korea that is said that has the strength to reach most of the United States, not to mention this potentially devastatingly expensive tax plan. I'd say that makes for a tough week. What do you think? Our security has been challenged on every front. There was a song out years ago that said, "Never was the world in such a need of peace." We need this kind of peace today. I don't know about you, but this kind of thing absolutely exhausts me. Every day, another gasp, another disappointment, yet another problem. I long for peace. That amazing kind of peace that Craig read from that wonderful poem by Maya Angelou, that peace that I imagine Mary had as she held on to baby Jesus. After her long ride to Bethlehem on the back of a donkey, no less, and after having spent the night delivering her firstborn and God's promised offspring. You know, that peace that happens when a baby enters the room. Lucado says, bring a baby into the room and everything changes. Grandma reaches up, grandpa wakes up, conversation shifts from politics and presidents to Pampers and pacifiers. This time of year, babies take center stage, and well, they should. Is not Christmas the story of a baby? Heaven's seed in womb in Mary, minuscule yet mighty, a fetus yet a force. God descended the birth canal, born. Creator cradled in a Bethlehem barn, infant yet infinite, asleep, yet a king. God gurgles in his mother's arms. God is a baby. This is the Christmas moment, Lucado continues, which shaped all the other moments to follow. On a starlit night, in the company of sheep, cattle, and a bewildered Joseph, Mary's eyes fall upon the face of her just-born son. She was bone-weary, surely, in pain, likely, ready to place her head on the straw around her and sleep the rest of the night away? Probably. But Mary had to see his face. And she, the first one to whisper, "So this is what God looks like." For our consideration this morning on this first Sunday of Advent, amidst this chaotic world in which we are currently living, I would recommend that not only do we need peace, but we can have peace because God has a face. Because God has a face, we find that peace once we embrace these following three things that God having a face can teach us. Number one, I recommend that we can know God is unlike what is most expected, yet precisely what we need. Number two, we can know that God is with us, Emmanuel. And thirdly, we can know God can relate to our personal pain. Let's begin with God being unlike what the world expected, but precisely what it needed. The Hebrews were expecting, you remember, a conquering king, a strong savior, a dominating dealer of their enemies. And throughout the Hebrew scriptures, God had been depicted as a golden calf, a violent wind, and an angry volcano. And as a result, we've often fancied God as ferocious and fickle, maniacal and mean. Wow. We've been warned that God is to be avoided and dreaded, appeased and doted. And then God does what nobody else would have ever imagined. Because God loves us and wants nothing but the very best for us, God sent God's self, the one and only begotten Son. The Apostle Paul says in the second chapter of Philippians that though Jesus was in the form of God, thought not equality with God as something to be grasped or held onto, but he emptied himself, becoming in human form, being found in the likeness of a slave, and humbled himself even to the point of death. Paul says, even death on a cross. God, you see, showed up as a baby and entered our world as this helpless tiny infant in the midst of a barred barn. And not because there was no better option, there was no other option available to him. No luxury birthing suite for Mary and her baby, just the hard ground and some hay. That stresses me out. How might this kind of God make things right and defeat God's enemies? Perhaps we have the enemies wrong. Without sword and not to destroy armies by leveling cities as they had hoped. But Jesus came to demolish social topography by leveling societal structure and class systems and put us all on the same level.
Right.
And you know what? We've gotten it wrong ever since.
Right.
We're still trying to stack up those societies and we're still trying to be better than someone else. Jesus came to demolish all that, and we've missed the point, but that's not my point. God came as a person, a tiny baby, in fact, to remind us that God wasn't coming to bring about political victory and establish an earthly empire, but to show us precisely what God looks like. And God looks like love and joy and hope, and today God looks like peace. Nothing we expected, but everything we needed. At the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, the disciples wanted Jesus to fight his enemies, and instead, Jesus turned around and forgave them. Totally not what they expected. When Jesus is hanging on the cross between two thieves, one of those thieves said, "Get down from here and get the rest of us down and save us. Save yourself and save us in the process," you know, just the three of them. And Jesus decided to die instead to save all of us. Just look what God can do. Yeah. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He moved into our neighborhood. He came and lived among us, and because of that, we beheld God's glory. Glory revealed through a servant's heart. God came a baby, and came as a baby, not as a bully, as we would have hoped. And because of that, we now can know peace. Unexpected, yet amazing. God has a face so that we might know peace. Not only did he come unexpectedly with a face, but having a face allowed us to understand, secondly, that God is with us. God is Emmanuel, which literally means God with us. And you remember several times throughout the Gospels how Jesus showed up in those difficult places. Once, Jesus had just fed that multitude, that 5,000 men, not including women and children, so tons and tons, probably 20,000 people. And then the scripture says Jesus had to go to the mountain to pray. If Jesus had to pray, y'all better get to praying.
Come on now.
And then Jesus goes up on the mountain and he sends the disciples, remember, onto the lake, onto the Sea of Galilee. And while Jesus is up praying, they're riding along on the lake, and all of a sudden, as would happen on the Sea of Galilee, a storm brews. And it begins to toss the boat to and fro, and the disciples are terrified. I imagine most of them couldn't swim, and they're frightened because they're out here and they can't see a thing. It's dark. But all of a sudden, on the horizon comes something, and at first they think it's a ghost, but it's Jesus. And as he got close to them, remember, he said, "Calm down. It's me. It's okay," right? And he calmed the raging storm around them. You've been in a storm, right? You've been in the midst of some difficult, turbulent times. And saints, you need to know, because God has a face, God is with you in the storm, right? He's not up on the mountain still praying and hoping you are right. He's right there with you in the storm. When the woman caught in the very act of adultery is drug out from her bed to the center of town where Jesus was standing, the Pharisees brought her to him so that they might see how he would interpret the law, which allowed them to stone this woman right there. With rocks in hand, they stand and they wait for Jesus to do something about her. And what does Jesus do? He looked in the eyes of everyone standing there with their rocks ready to be tossed, and he said, "Any one of you without sin, go ahead and cast the first stone," right? Not a stone was thrown. He dropped the stones to the ground, and they walked away, and there Jesus stood in the midst of the stones around her and reminded her he was with her. But encouraged her, go and sin no more. Don't do this again. Right? Amidst the stones, he stood with her. And then when Lazarus, his very good friend and Mary and Martha's brother, when he took ill and they called for Jesus to come home and he was late, Jesus gets there and they're standing by his grave and they're upset that had he been there, Lazarus wouldn't have died. And Jesus stood at that grave and instead of fussing at them or being upset with them as they were upset with him, what did Jesus do? He cried with them at the grave. Saints, you've been at a grave. We've been at graves from all of our friends who passed because of HIV and AIDS, and we've stood and we've moaned and we've hurt and we're still upset at all those people that have passed. I was thinking of more and more names and I was overwhelmed with how do I know so many people that have passed. But saints, Jesus is standing there with us at the grave, because you see, God has a face and God doesn't let us go through anything that God is not with us in it. So saints, you can have peace because Jesus has a face of God. And saints, not only that, Jesus understands our pain. Jesus was almost pushed off a cliff because he said his mission was to come and release captives and recover sight to the blind and to let oppressed people go free. And they wanted people still blind, still oppressed, and still not free. And they wanted to push him off a cliff. He felt our pain of being excluded from places where others were included. Jesus was ostracized from many places because he went through Samaria where others would not even go. He cared for the foreigner and he opened his door to any and everybody, lepers and those who were ill. Jesus was with them and understood their pain. Jesus cried in a garden of Gethsemane, asking God to let the cup pass from him. You ever ask God to not let this happen anymore? Jesus has been where you are. And he ended up on a cross anyway. Jesus understands your pain. There's a story about a man, a missionary, who understood pain. He went to build this medical facility, and he also built not only the medical facility, but he built a chapel there in Africa, and he went to serve God's people there. And then the locals were receptive to him and helped him construct both the clinic and the chapel. But eventually, Dr. Harley treated more than 10,000 patients a year at this clinic. But during the first 5 years that he was there, not one of those people from the tribe visited the chapel. Shortly after he and his wife arrived, he gave birth to their firstborn child, Robert. The boy grew up on the edge of the forest, and the doctor said he was the apple of our eye, how we loved our little boy. But one day when he was almost five, the doctor said, "I looked out the window of the medical dispensary and I saw Bobby. He was running across the field, but he fell down, and he got up and ran some more, and then he fell again, but this time he didn't get up. So I went and I picked him up, and he was feverish, and I held him in my arms, and he said, "Bobby, don't worry. Your daddy knows how to treat this tropical fever. I'm going to help you get better." And Dr. Harley tried every treatment at his disposal, yet nothing helped. The fever raged, and in short order, the disease took his little boy's life. Both Dr. Harley and his wife were distraught with grief. The missionary went into his workshop, and he built his own son's coffin. He placed that little boy inside and nailed the lid. And then he lifted the coffin on his shoulder and began walking toward a clearing to find a place to dig a grave. One of the old men of the village saw him and asked about the box. Dr. Harley explained that his son had died and that he was going to find a place to bury him, and the old man offered to help carry the coffin. Dr. Harley told a friend what happened next. He said, "So the old man took one end of the coffin and I took the other. Eventually we came to the clearing in the forest and we dug a grave and laid my Bobby in it. But when we had covered the grave, I couldn't stand it any longer. I fell down on my knees on the dirt and began to sob uncontrollably. My beloved son was dead, and there I was in the middle of the African jungle, 8,000 miles from home, and I felt so all alone. But when I started crying, the old man cocked his head in stunned amazement. He squatted down beside me and he looked at me so intently. For a long time, he sat there just listening to me cry. And then suddenly he leaped to his feet and he began running back through the jungle, screaming again and again at the top of his lungs, 'White man, he cries like one of us.' That evening, as Harley and his wife grieved in their cottage, there was a knock at the door. Harley opened it. There stood the chief of the tribe and almost every man, woman, and child from that village. They were back again the next Sunday and filled the chapel to overflowing. They wanted now to hear about Jesus. Everything changes when the villagers saw the tears of the missionary. Everything changes, saints, when we see the face of God. Others will not care how much you know until they know how much you care.
Amen.
Everything changes when we see the face of God in each other. May we find that kind of peace in the midst of this Advent season, because God came as an unexpected person and went about continuing his mission in very unexpected ways. God is with us in the storm, amid the rocks, at the grave, and God can relate to your pain because God has shared in your pain. May that peace that Jesus said only he could give you strength to face the world in which we live, this turbulent, crazy world. Peace in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.